world is in crisis.
การแก้ไขปัญหาโควิดถือเป็นวาระแห่งชาติ
And people are looking for hope and answers. Thai PBS World is there with you, with the best minds of the day. Join us on Thai PBS World tonight, every weekdays at 7 p.m. Thai PBS World, we bring Thailand to the world.
สวัสดีค่ะ very good evening and welcome to our 7 o'clock news Thai PBS World tonight I am Natha Gomulwadin
and good evening I'm Thep Chai Yong another day of good news another day without a single case of locally transmitted infection and not even a single case of imported infection right and in a few weeks time we are most likely to see a revival of local tourism in Thailand
Yes.
With the major package of tourism adopted by the cabinet today.
Yes, mm-hmm. budget has already been approved,
right. yeah.
so people can look forward to travel in Thailand. But today the new cases is zero, Khun Thep Chai, zero of new case and zero new death. And assistant spokesperson for COVID-19 situation administration, Dr. Pannapha Yongtrakoon,She said that it has been 22 consecutive days that Thailand has no local transmitted infection. But she also warned the Thai public to still remain vigilant to wearing face masks in public, frequently hand washing, social distancing, and avoid congested area as Thailand continue to ease lockdown restrictions.
All right, so.Certainly, I mean, good news, but again, we need to always keep our guard high, right? We are learning some lessons from some of the countries which have seen
yes.
zeroed case of infections, and then all of a sudden, there was a new round of outbreak. So that's something that we have to be very mindful about. And the government has finally come up with what is probably the biggest domestic travel promotion plan in Thailand's history.The cabinet today approved a package of tourism incentives that are designed to jumpstart the tourist industry, which has been hard hit by the coronavirus pandemic. Under these programs, as much as 22.4 billion baht will be spent to encourage people to travel domestically. The travel stimulus plan was proposed by the Ministry of Tourism and Sports and Ministry of Finance and will run from July to October.And we want to tell every one of you who are watching us that you are also entitled to take advantage of the incentives, which are open to all. And now, Kunata, let's take a look at the details of these incentives.
Yes. The government has outlined three incentive programs. The first one, Let's Travel Together. They will provide subsidies for 5 million hotel nights.Subsidy for up to 40% of room rates, but not exceeding 3,000 baht per night. And subsidies for food and other services at 600 baht per night and maximum of 5 nights.
And as much as 18 billion baht will be spent on these incentives. The idea is to encourage people to travel as much as possible. And that's why the incentives are so attractive, Kunata.
Yes.And for hotel that want to join this program, they have to register with State Bank, Krung Thai Bank as well, Khun Thep Chai.
That's right, yes.
And for the second incentive program, it's Sharing Happiness Tour. Subsidy for domestic travel for 2 million people, maximum of 1,000 baht per person. And every hotel reservation entails right to buy discounted air ticket of 2,500 baht each.
And of course, there are limits to how much people can spend and expecting to be subsidized by the government.
Yeah. So But each will be given 1,000 baht to cover 40% of their travel by air, public bus, or by rented car. The cost of this package is estimated at 2 billion baht. And the third one, Moral Support Incentive Program.Is travel subsidies of 2,000 baht each for medical personnel and health volunteers. And the trip must be 2 days or more. That's a big reward for personnel.
I think they deserve this kind of treatment because by now we all know that without the hard work and sacrifices by medical personnel and health volunteers, Thailand would not have come this far in its fight against the coronavirus. And to demonstrate its appreciation for the contribution of these people, the government today, I mean, adopted this package to make sure that health personnel and health volunteers would take time out from this hard work, I mean, to go out and enjoy themselves. And yeah, as we said, they certainly deserve this kind of treatment.
Yes. The package for medical personnel in particular is estimated to cost the taxpayer of about 2.4 billion baht. And the funding of the three packages will come from the 1.9 trillion baht budget, intended to cushion the impacts of the economy and the Thai people from COVID-19 pandemic. It is probably the best solution right now, Khun Thepchai, in order to revive local tourism industry.
It's quite clear that all these incentives are basically designed to help revitalize the tourism industry, especially hotels, I mean, restaurants and tour company. And because the package that deals with the travel by medical personnel, it makes it essential that all travel by these people must be done through tour companies. That means that the business will be given to tour company to arrange trips for this medical personnel. And as we have tens of thousands of tour companies that have suffered from the impact from the pandemic, so this is certainly will come as a great help to these travel companies.
And probably it's a good opportunity for Thai people to get to know more about Thailand and to visit many cities which perhaps not main tourist destination before.
But there's one condition for those who want to take advantage of these incentive package. You need to travel outside the provinces that you live in, the provinces where you register your household. That means that if you live in Bangkok, then you need to travel outside Bangkok to be eligible for these subsidies from the government. You can do that in Bangkok and claim for subsidies.
But the outline, the plan by the government, they doesn't specify whether they will ask organization or public sector to provide like long weekend holidays or long work break from those organizations, probably. Because last time when we talked to tourism minister, he mentioned that perhaps public sector or private organization can provide long weekends for their staff.
And we mustn't forget the fact that the government still owes us, I mean, holidays left over from the Songkran festival, right?
Yeah.
Those substitute holidays that were canceled and were promised to be returned to us when the time is right. So everybody's looking forward to these substitute holidays, most likely in July or August when these travel promotion plan takes shape, right?
Yeah, and people still calculate overall holidays that they can have this year after they have to postpone from Songkran holiday.
Yes. And what you're seeing now on the screen is the tourism minister, Khun Pipat Ratchakit Prakarn, who today also has some good news to convey to the public about the so-called travel bubble, Khun Nattha. As you know, that the tourism and sports ministry is pinning its hope on the so-called travel bubble to jumpstart Thailand's tourism industry, which has suffered heavily from the impact of the coronavirus pandemic. And at this point, it looks very likely that the idea will start taking shape in a matter of weeks now. Khun Pipat told Thai PBS today that he expects to see the first group of foreign visitors to Thailand as part of the travel bubble arrangement in the first week of July, that is a few weeks from now. He said there will be strictly be businessmen, technicians, and people who require medical services at Thai hospitals. And he said a committee comprising officials from the Ministries of Interior, Foreign Affairs, Public Health, and Tourism is working on a list of countries with which Thailand will form travel bubble with. So travel bubble is a special travel arrangement between Thailand and specific countries or specific groups of countries which have good records in containing the coronavirus pandemic.
But this is quite interesting because it's travel bubble and Thailand will have to have specific guidelines for those tourists from other countries. For example, they won't be able to roam freely and they can only go to places which have high disease control capabilities. And this is the guideline for the reception of foreign tourists, according to Prime Minister Prayut Chan-o-cha. And he said it's safer and better than liberalized tourism.
Yeah. Of course, then there is a question as to when foreign tourists will be allowed to return to Thailand, because this will be the perfect, the ultimate answer to revitalizing tourism industry here. So the tourism minister told Thai PBS World that if the first phase of travel bubble proves successful, then there is a possibility that Thailand will open its door to foreign tourists in the following month or so for a period of trial. Mm-hmm. Authorities are looking at certain tourist destinations that could be open to foreign tourists in the initial stage as part of the travel bubble plan. They include Phuket, Krabi, and Samui in the south. The tourism minister said because of their geographical locations, these places make it easier for authorities to monitor tourists and enforce health control measures.
Because it's travel bubble, so it's special arrangement between Thailand and other countries. So it doesn't mean that tourists will have to be in state quarantine.
No.
They don't have to, but they cannot roam freely anywhere in Thailand.
Because the most important thing is to make sure that these tourists are from country that have proved themselves to be successful in containing the virus. In fact, we have a list of some countries already, Kunatha, which are most likely to be among the first groups of countries that will enter into this special arrangement with Thailand. Mm-hmm. Of course, the names of Japan, New Zealand, Australia, some of the Scandinavian countries have been mentioned. But of course, with the recent second wave happening in countries like New Zealand or China, then there could be some question as to whether we should take another look at this list or not.
But as far as we know, they haven't specified a specific set of the country yet for travel bubble, so we have to stay put and see what the decision will be taken by the government.
Yeah, in fact, there's a committee now that is working very hard to decide which countries should be included in this initial stage of the travel bubble plan. And they will have to come up with answers to as to why these countries are chosen, because I'm sure that there will be a lot of questions from people in local areas that may be concerned that any foreign arrivals here could pose a risk of spreading of the virus. So this committee has to be very, very certain that they have all the answers ready when they come up with this list to be announced publicly.
Yeah, but it's another option to revive local tourism and international tourism as well. And Khun Thepchai, today there is another development on the help for people who are facing difficulty,
financial help. That's right, because despite the government's cash handouts and other relief measures a few weeks ago, there are still millions of people out there who have been impacted by the coronavirus pandemic and are still waiting for help. Of course, we all remember the scenes of thousands of people queuing up to register for the 5,000 baht monthly handout, right? And the cabinet today approved another four aid packages, especially for people who were not covered by the earlier state assistance programs. They include the over 1.1 million holders of state welfare cards, who under the new assistance program will be given 1,000 baht each for a period of 3 months. And the package is worth about 3.49 billion baht. And then there's another group of people who missed out from the initial assistance program after failing to register for cash handouts on the government's special Nobody Left Behind website, right? Remember that? And a budget of 900 million baht has been allocated for this particular group. And then the third group comprises people officially classified as being in a fragile state, who include poor and old people, as well as people with disabilities and children of poor families. And then, of course, the fourth group is farmers, who number over close to 300,000 who also need assistance from the government. Mm-hmm.
So people who are waiting for cash handout and other kinds of subsidy and financial help, they can look forward to all of this providing from the government. And with the potential second wave or more infection right now, in addition to China, New Zealand is another country which has announced that they have more infection after being free from COVID-19 for quite some time. And right now we have Kunnat Bunak joining us for this story. So what's really coming up with New Zealand?
Today, New Zealand has found two new cases of COVID-19, and that puts an end to a 24-day streak of seeing no new infections in the country. And if we all remember last week, the New Zealand government actually declared victory over the coronavirus. So the two new cases has brought a total to 1,506 cases in total, and the death toll remains at 22. The two new cases in New Zealand recently came back from the United Kingdom. Based on the local media, they were given special permission to attend a funeral in New Zealand as well.
So what will happen, because they lift restriction last week, but today they have two more cases?
I think New Zealand has to be more careful now, but previously the Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern also said that although they declared victory over the coronavirus, but that doesn't mean the battle is over yet. Although the restrictions are not there anymore, but what we are still seeing in New Zealand is that the border restrictions are still in place. So the citizens of New Zealand, as well as essential workers, are allowed to enter the country. So that means foreigners like us still cannot enter New Zealand. And all arrivals must go through a 14-day period of isolation or quarantine, and they also have to be tested for the virus twice.
I think these two new cases are quite interesting. They are two returnees from the UK, right? And they were allowed to leave the quarantine even before they were diagnosed or were even tested for coronavirus, and they traveled over 600 kilometers to visit their, of course, the dying parent. It's quite unfortunate. And this is considered to be part of the so-called compassionate exemption for people in distress and need to really travel. So what has been the reaction from the authorities then, I mean, on this kind of exemption?
I haven't really seen the real reaction yet, but in fact, there's one interesting information that I found is that people under quarantine after arriving in New Zealand from overseas, which country you came from, are actually not allowed to attend a funeral. But if they've been through quarantine for at least a week or have been tested negative, then they can attend a small family gathering to grieve, but not really a funeral. But what we've been seeing is that some people have already granted special permission to attend a funeral because they've already went through quarantine, and as well as passing certain criteria, such as have medical details of the person they've visited during the quarantine, or what they've been, basically the travel history and what they've been doing. So that might be the reason why they granted the special permission. But a bit of a background information, the two new cases arrived in New Zealand from the UK on the 7th of June via Doha and Brisbane. And then when they arrived in Auckland, they entered self-quarantine at an isolation hotel. So during that time, they applied for exemption to visit their dying parent, like you said earlier, on 12th of June, and they granted permission to travel to Wellington on the next day because they actually applied for an exemption to visit their dying parent here.
So what would be measured by the government? They will announce lockdown or other restrictive measures?
For the government, they would be putting on alert at the moment for the citizens because of the two new cases that we've been hearing about. So probably it's more of a warning at the moment so that people remain vigilant on the situation. Well, even last week, if we all remember when they eased all the restrictions already, so that means the four-tier levels, from the highest, they are now on the lowest. So that means social distancing is not applied anymore, but people still has to be on alert and be careful when they go outside.
Yeah, so it reminds us all in Thailand that we have to keep our guard up in order to cope with all the new infection.
Okay. Definitely.
Thank you very much, Kunat.
Thank you.
So that's the situation in New Zealand, that so suddenly after having COVID free for about 2 weeks or so, right now they are facing two new cases. And back to Thailand, the owner of Michelin star has their idea in order to provide food for Thai locals who are having difficulty during this COVID-19 infection. So let's see how they provide food supply for people in local community in Bangkok. Take a look at this report by Khun Kittipat Chunsukjit.
When a nationwide lockdown stranded her thousands of miles from her business and career in Paris, Natalie Binnakbasert turned her focus to a new venture, building a network of volunteers, including Michelin-starred chefs, to help feed those in Thailand most affected by the pandemic and its restrictions. The group called COVID Thailand Aid says it has reached over 30,000 people with care package and freshly cooked food in over 100 locations. In bright blue t-shirts, she and her volunteers pass a box of spicy minced chicken and rice into the hands of the residents in need. They also give essential items including clothing, hand sanitizers, and masks. There are 82 households here. Most people work as maids, street vendors, or shop assistants, and many haven't worked for around 2 months.
มันมีความหมายหลายๆอย่างตอนนี้เราลำบากมากๆเลยแม้แต่จะส่งข้าวบ้านยังไม่มีเลย
จินตนาจันทรศรี one of the community elders says it means a lot to her as she is facing difficulties. She can't even pay rent. Many have no jobs and can't sell anything. Everything is tough. Already hesitant to travel because of the coronavirus, Natalie's new direction really started after a flight ban stopped her scheduled return to France, where she runs property and e-commerce businesses, and the spur to act lay close to home.
The original idea was my grandma. She's 94 years old, and then I really worried about her during COVID, like how is she going to cope and do things. So I just thought about all the people who are struggling during this time, who might not even have a family or a home. So I just started really small in an easy way, started helping people buying groceries in their area. And now we're like more than 450 volunteers, and we're doing food donations, care packages. We've helped in over 32 provinces.
On the menu, 300 meals of Phat Krapao Kai, the spicy minced chicken destined for the railway side community. Rarely has this staple street food dish been cooked to such a high standard. Three of the restaurants involved are Michelin starred.
I think we just kind of throw out the idea of any Michelin anymore, and it's just about getting together and just trying to feed people and make sure that people have access to good food and that will make them feel good about themselves and help families that are in need.
Natalie hopes that the initiative can continue even after the COVID-19 crisis is over, because even though restrictions are gradually relaxing, there has been no let-up in the number of requests for help.
That's initiative by COVID Thailand Aid to help people who need food supply during COVID-19. And overall, after the fighting, the battle with COVID-19 in the past few months, what's really coming up on especially medical personnel who has been working frontline, whether they feel relieved with the current situation. Right now, we have Dr. Thanarak Phalipat, Deputy Director General of Disease Control Department, joining us live in the studio. Sawasdee ka,
thank you very much for joining us.
Okay, it's a great honor for you to be with us physically for the first time after we have been talking online for almost 3 months now, right?
Yes, okay. Yes, more than 2 months, yeah.
So we have been confronting this pandemic for close to 4 months now, right?
For me.
Yeah, for us, longer. The country as well, right?
Yeah, that's right.
But is the way you look at the pandemic today different from the way you did, say, 4 months ago?
Oh, yes, of course. Of course. Let me begin from January 3rd.
Okay.
That was the third day that I did activate our emergency operations from January 3rd until today. It's already more than 6 months for me.
Wow. No holiday. Right. For you, no holiday at all?
No.
Working continuously.
Unfortunately,
so,
not.
So what was going through your mind the day that you decided to have this thing activated?
Yes. You know what? One of my professors, I graduated from Prince Songkhla University, from the south. Recently, he just wrote something about how Taiwan has activated their emergency operations. Okay. He said that one of the deputy director of the Taiwan CDCs, during the New Year's, he could not sleep, so he went up and read some line messages. and found one of the very interesting chat or message written by doctor who identified the outbreak in Wuhan. Then the next day he discussed it with his directors, and then came on January 2nd they activate their operations. Story is probably the same things. I heard the news from December 31st, but did not really pay that much attention to it. And on January 2nd, I got one of the message from my friends, said that.
From where? From?
From one of my old friends.
In Thailand?
In Thailand.
In Thailand.
Asked me about what happened in Wuhan.
Okay.
So on January 3rd, I did, since if you remember that week, the government opened for only 2 days. That is January 3rd, 2nd and January 3rd. So on January 3rd, I kind of asked certain questions to my colleagues. And during lunchtime, since it's a very, relaxed day, not much going on.
It's fresh from the New Year holiday, right?
Right. I went out for lunch in the restaurant and just kind of relaxed and read through the messages, live messages, and one of the messages is from my colleagues, saying something about what is going on in Wuhan and how many travelers we got from Wuhan. So after I finish readings, I have to finish
that
my lunch.
That's the alarm
quickly.
Bell. The alarm bell for you then.
Right, and then I came back and wrote the orders of activation and discussed it with my colleagues, and then ask permission to activate our emergency operations. That is how we get.
But was there any question from your colleagues or your superiors about whether or not we were in that state that urgent enough to have?
Oh yes, of course. I draft my emergency operations to activate it. We discussed for almost 4 hours, and most of the discussion is that nobody thinks we should alert the system yet. But gladly, I think I can.
And you were pushing hard for people to recognize the gravity of the situation.
Right. Because if we all remember, during that time, the news from China mentioned that there is no human to human transmission So no, at that time nobody think is going to get this big.
Okay. All right, so thanks to your attention Otherwise, we would have been in much deeper trouble. So.
lots of confusion. Very, very, in the very beginning of the outbreak, especially when it happened in China.
Right.
And these days, can you sleep okay?
Yes, of course. although there are still so many things to do, but things get more relaxed for me. I kind of have, although it's still no more, not 9 to 5. I think it's 7 to 11, something 7-11, 7-11 days still. But things kind of not that rush anymore for me. So I start to clear up some of my duties already. So try to catch up with so many things. So it's getting better.
Okay. But what is your personal feeling having you and your colleagues also having to tell the public bad news every day?
To me, I think it is both way. It's depending on how we look at the issue. To me, I think we are still very lucky this time around, although some may say no. But if you look at fatality rate or mortality rate, it is not that really high. It's high only among elderly, but the mortality rate among very young population is still very low. Yeah. To me, I think this is although the situation is not good in several countries, but still, it is not that bad. So I would think that this is something like an alarm for us, so that we can really get prepared for really worse pandemic in the future. I think this epidemic or this pandemic taught us quite a lot. And if we can really learn from it, when the worst come, then we will be prepared. I hope it will not come very soon, although.
So you mean we have to bear with bad news from doctors, right? Because it helps save lives.
That's, kind of, I guess.
Yeah, but the situation in China is like warning of potential second wave. Do you think Thailand should be very much aware of it?
Yes. Before this coming here on this evening, I came across one of the quote from the Prime Minister of New Zealand. And New Zealand is one of the very good countries that they already can control the outbreaks. And she said something like, the situation in New Zealand at this time is quite good. And she expected that probably there may be a few more cases that happen, but they are not that afraid, and it is not unexpected. And she said that, but we will be prepared for that situation. I think we should have the same mentalities. If we have new cases or have whatever we do, and then following that actions, there may be a few cases occurring. I don't think we should be panic. I think what we should do is that we use what we have learned and prepare for, and use those opportunity and use our strength to try to control it.
You know, the new cluster of infections in Beijing now has been traced back to a food market in the city. And of course, in Wuhan, it still yet need to be proven that the origin of the infection was at the wildlife market or not. But that seems to be the case for the moment anyway. But with this information, should we take a look at Thailand at these places, the markets? And
I think we should be careful as well. What China is trying to investigate at the moment, I think they have two hypotheses. That is probably the contamination of COVID-19 may happen well before the market. So they have two hypotheses. Probably it's contaminated from the source of salmon. And second hypothesis is the salmon was contaminated within the market or in China. So we have to look at that very carefully and follow the news. Because if it happened at the source, then we may be in yeah. the same situation as China as well.
Dr. Thanarang, you said you have learned a lot from COVID-19. For you, what is the most important lesson in dealing with it?
You know, something I can say, but something I cannot. Let me say what I can say.
Well, like to hear what you cannot say.
Yeah. Okay, you can start with what you yeah. can say first.
Right. I think first of all, before we have the crisis, and you all know that I worked in the field of public health emergency management for more than 10 years, about 13 years to be exact. Mm. So it is one of my baby, I would say. Mm. I work on is try to establish our public health emergency management, emergency operation centers, as well as what we now call health securities. Those are the programs that I fall in love with, and I work for it for so many years. And last year, there was a study published by Johns Hopkins University said that we are very good. We are number 6 in the world and number 1 in Asia. I kind of very surprised myself. I kind of knew that we were kind of good, but I don't know how good we are. This time around, after so many energies have been put into building strong system, I think it's really paid off. Mm. And although we are not perfect, but at least we knew it worked. Mm. So I'm glad. That is one thing I'm so glad about. But still, in trying to improve our public health emergency management, I think there are still a long way to go. So, there are a lot of things that we have to do, not just the system, the infrastructure that we have to improve. Also, how we work, that is the operation system, and also our human resources, that is the most important things, that they have to be rigorous in training even more, so that they can perform at the higher level.
But Thailand is being appreciated as the top 2nd of the world in dealing with COVID-19.
Yes.
What do you think is the major ingredient of success in Thailand?
I think so many things. One thing that I'm so proud of that I kind of have a chance to work on this as well is that we prepare very well in advance. For example, we have what we call Communicable Disease Control Unit, the team that went out to investigate all of the 3,000 cases to identify who they contact with, and then doing all the contact tracing with help from health volunteers. But our investigation teams, what we call CDCU, Communicable Disease Control Unit, we have trained those close to 1,000 teams. And about 2 or 3 years ago, I thought that, well, with the experience from MERS, I think we should have the teams that can went out and investigate what we call dangerous pathogen, like MERS, SARS, like Ebola. Then 3 or 4 years before that, we have only a few teams that can do it. I mean, really a few teams, less than 10. But before this outbreak occurs, we have close to 100 teams that can perform these high-risk activities. That is something that is very important. And those 100 teams can also supervise a less experienced team. We have around 800 to 1,000 teams, so that they can perform their duties very well. I think it's I am so proud of them, and I think they make our country proud as well.
No, but there are also critics who believe that the prescription given by doctors in dealing with the pandemic are unnecessarily strong, and some believe that the cure is worse than the disease.
Right.
Right. And right. Some even accuse doctors of being used by politicians to justify the unnecessary draconian measures, including the curfew and the state of emergency. How do you respond to this kind of observations?
That is something I think based on what we learn now, some measures may, some people may feel that some of the recommendation may be, I mean, you know, overreact.
Mm-hmm.
And probably because it affects a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
But I have to say that I have to defend everybody that, that is the situation that nobody's really, really faced this kind of, mm-hmm. of emergency before. If we look back in our lifetimes, there has never been any epidemics that caused this kind of disruption before. We never, I myself at the beginning, I don't think that anybody will go this far in order to control mm-hmm. the epidemics like what China did. They closed down their countries, they closed down their cities, and they have 24 hours curfew for the city of Wuhan. Mm-hmm. To me, I think what we did for Bangkok and for some of the provinces is appropriate.
Mm.
It may not be appropriate for certain provinces, of course, but if we are not doing that, there may be a lot of movement of sure. population anyways. For example, if I say that I'm going to ban the selling of alcoholic beverage in this and that provinces, do you think that people from the provinces that don't have, I mean, will people travel from the province that banned the alcohol and go into the other province that don't sell alcohol? That may be the case. Or
okay.
let's say there was a joke that, well, if Nonthaburi allow the barber shop to open, mm-hmm. then if I live in Bangkok, I'm going to drive.
Big rush by right, people in Bangkok to have them right. to see the barber.
Right. So we don't want that to happen.
Okay.
So we never tried. We never experimented before. Mm-hmm. We don't know the other side of the coin,
mm-hmm.
Or we never see the other side of the moon. Anyways. Mm-hmm. So I think we have to, so that is our judgment, our decision at that time.
Okay.
So we never know what will happen if we do the other otherwise.
So
I'm not going to question myself on those kind of critique. I think we done it, and with the result, I think everybody should celebrate what we have done.
So you are admitting that the doctors have a hand in introducing the ban on alcohol sales and the curfew, the imposition of curfew, right?
If we go back at that time, if you ask me if it is okay with the decision of having curfew, I said it's appropriate.
Okay.
If you remember the sequence, it's not. We implement the curfew right away.
Mm.
We start with the closure of nightclub first. And then the days that we imposed those rules, the next day there was a gathering at public places to drink, for example, on the Bang San Beach, if you remember.
Yeah, remember that.
And that's a few days later, that is when the curfew occurs.
Mm.
And if you remember, during that time, not just on Bang San Beach, that we have several incidents that people gathering around in certain public places. So that is when actually the Prime Minister decided that we should have curfew.
Okay.
And I, at that time, I have to admit that I also support the ideas of having those, because the situation at that time is not good at all.
Yeah, yeah.
Thai people tend to forget very quickly. I mean, if we go back and look at what happened on the week of March 17 and after that, I think everybody kind of, well, what happened and what should we do about it?
Yeah, very panic. Right. Yeah.
And people talk a lot about new normal.
New normal.
During the age of COVID-19.
Yes.
But look at the whole situation right now, fourth phase of easing restriction. People seem back to nearly normal already.
Right.
People just enjoy shopping, enjoy all activities, mm-hmm. just like before.
Right.
Any concern for you that perhaps, probably Thai people have very short memory, cannot learn to deal with COVID-19?
You can expect what doctor would say anyway. I'll say on the side of caution, right?
I mean, not. There are so many things that really good happened in the last few weeks, in the last few months, I think, especially in April. Mm-hmm. And I think if we learn and if we think hard and if we adjust the way we live our life, mm-hmm. I think there will be good thing happen. For example, during the month of April, we try to work from home quite a lot. And the traffic in Bangkok just like never before for the whole month.
Yeah.
And I checked all the data. I mean, there is probably one thing that I haven't looked at is how happy we were during that time. But if you look at the gasoline consumption in the country, it's dropped quite a lot. The traffic or the times that we use traveling in Bangkok dropped rapidly. The time that we spend on the road is also, I mean, dropped quite a lot. And also the pollution scale or measurement in Bangkok also dropped quite a lot. And if we look at, I mean, everything's combined, I think there are a lot of, they teach us a lesson.
Right. Yeah.
And to me, I'm so happy with what's happening in the month of April. We learn to work online, we learn to work away from each other. In the past, let's say, if I have a meetings, probably, let's say, just 1 hour meetings, that's mean all afternoon.
One
hour travel to go to the meetings, 1 hour at the meetings, and 1 hour coming back from the meeting to the office. That is my all 3 hours.
Yeah.
Now 1 hour meeting is really 1 hour meetings. Just open the computers.
Yeah, that's true.
Can enjoy the meetings. And recently I have studied a lot of, about work from home. And I saw both on both sides, there is a benefit and there is the ways that we have to make it efficient. So I think what we should try to go for, what we should learn from the situation and try to move forward with those kind of lessons is very important for our society.
I believe so. I think whether you call it new normal or not, but I think we don't need to wait for a pandemic to happen before we take a good look at ourselves and how we conduct our daily lives, right?
That's right, that's right. And I think because of the necessity probably that start to for us to raise certain questions. I wrote in one of my document that there are, for example, the government, especially Prime Minister, push us quite a lot as a government employees, as a civil servants, to go through the process of digital transformation, to bring the digital technologies to improve our services for our population. I believe that he said it for more than 3 or 4 years with Thailand 4.0, with so many projects. But look at us at the moment. I think it's all moved so slow. There are so many things that we can do. And with COVID coming and hit me in my face, I really kind of woke up quite a lot. And really, although I would say since I am supervised our IT project at my department, we try to work very hard for that. But with COVID, when COVID came, it's really tell me that we have to move even faster than that.
So as a citizen, not as a doctor, how do you see the performance of our Prime Minister in handling the situation?
Prime Minister, you want me to grade?
as a citizen, not as a doctor.
I think he handled situation very well. I will say that with what he did, I think it was great. I just feel like it is us, it is our side that probably did not, I mean, think fast enough or work fast enough so that we can provide him with a better alternative or better strategies. I think when the situation did arrive or when the epidemic started to go up, at that time everybody kind of kind of have to work even faster. And during that time, I think that there was a lot of confusion, of course. But I don't think it is from the leader's side, but it is from our side that cannot catch up with the situation at that time. It is very important for the strategic people to come up with a good strategy with with the ways that we have to present our information for our leaders to make decision upon hard decisions. To me, I blame it on myself or my teams that we are not quick enough and not sharp enough during that time.
You have been through many pandemic like MERS, SARS, and this time COVID-19. And what have you learned about yourself in being through all this situation?
For myself?
Yes.
Oh, so many things. I am what I am today. It is because the way that I learn through my experience. There are so many things.
No, I'm sure that a lot of young people are inspired by the sacrifices and hard work by doctors and medical personnel. So inspired that I believe that many would want to become doctors themselves in the future. So what would you want to say to these young people who wanting to become doctors?
That's great.
Yeah, yeah.
I would say that being a doctor is, I enjoy what I do every day, and I like this job.
What is the most rewarding part of being a doctor?
I think when you say that, when you do good deed, the good will return to you.
Okay.
This is what happens every day. You are doing something good, it's just snap, just like that.
Instantly.
It's happened. If you work as if you take care of the patient at the hospitals, when you do good things happen just right away. So your patient's just getting better. It's the same thing here. When we know that we are doing good, everything just click, and our country getting better day by day, minute by minute. So it's really rewarding. We know that we are important part of our societies. We know that we are doing a good job, and we can see it. And if we make a bad decision, we can see it right away too.
And what would be the most difficult part of being a doctor?
The most difficult part? Yeah. It's never happened to me. I think when I discuss with my friend, probably the most difficult part is you have to make decisions. This is long time ago when I was very young. When we have to make decisions to let someone leave and not treat someone. Just like the situation in Italy. Yeah. Instead of you think about how to save life, you have to make decisions on who you are going to save. And there may be, for a lot of people, have to make those decisions. Probably because the ICU is not enough. So today you have to make decision on with the number of ICU bed that you have, who you are going to give that bed to.
Now, I'm sure that this pandemic will not be the last pandemic that we will face. I think there should be other that will come along. So what would you want to say to future leaders of the country, future decision makers, if they confront with this kind of crisis again? What do you expect them to do, and what lessons do you want to convey to them? I'm talking about future now, not talking about the current leaders.
Right. I think that this one of the good reasons that we are here today is that because unlike what happened in some countries, that the leaders just lead. to whatever its ways.
Yeah.
But here in Thailand, I think. It is not happened that way. I think we use science, we use evidence, and the leaders listen to the person that he should listen to. And I think that that is one thing that, that helped us today. So, and there are so many other things. When the leaders need to make difficult decisions, I like what the Prime Minister said one day, is that life of Thai people is the most important thing. And he is going to save life before saving other things. And you know what? That is the motto of public health emergency management. Number one priority is for any public health emergency is that we have to save life first, and then we can talk about other things later.
So, Doctor, you, in fact, the doctors deserve a break, and today the cabinet approved their package to encourage medical personnel to travel. Do you plan to take up that advantage? That
let me see.
You should have some break. We really appreciate your time to be with us on video call in the past 2 months, and then having regular, being regular commentator for us every Tuesday. Thank you very much joining us, for joining our program.
I would like to thank you too. I mean, this is the place that Ministry of Public Health and also our government can have a chance. I mean, to convey our message, not just to Thai but also to foreigners and to other, to the world as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you. But you still have to stay with us because we will, you will be joining us in Thai program as well. And that brings us to the end of Thai PBS World Tonight with the talk with Dr. Thanarak Palitpat, Deputy Director General of Disease Control Department. But please stay with us because we will be back at 8 p.m. to talk to the doctor in Thai, in Than Lok with Thai PBS World. And good night for Thai PBS World tonight.
Yeah, thank you for watching.
Is in crisis.
การแก้ไขปัญหาโควิดถือเป็นวาระแห่งชาติ
And people are looking for hope and answers. Thai PBS World is there with you, with the best minds of the day. Join us on Thai PBS World tonight, every weekdays at 7 p.m. Thai PBS World, we bring Thailand to the world. We'll be right back.